If I were to pick a time and a place and a personality from that place and use that as a starting point, could we find enough information to get an understanding of what that world was like? Let's try. It says here, the Duchess Eleanor of Aquitaine, born in 1122, was an intelligent and emancipated woman living in the dark Middle Ages. Here, it's the High Middle Ages, and she was one of the wealthiest and most powerful women. And here, it's feudal Europe, and she's one of the most powerful and fascinating personalities of the time. Well, what was it? Dark, high, or feudal? Using the definitions of modern-day scholars, it would actually be high and feudal. But for the people living then, it was none of the above, and it most certainly wasn't called Europe. Her name was actually pronounced Eleanor, and her father was the Duke of Aquitaine. He died when she was 15, and the area that she was left with was actually greater than that controlled by the King of the Franks, Louis VI. King Louis, apparently an overeater, was dying of dysentery, but he was of sound enough mind to see an opportunity to get those lands back under royal control. And he ordered his son, Louis Capet, and Eleanor to marry. It mentions here that she gave Louis a rock crystal vase as a wedding gift, and that it's currently on display at the Louvre. So, if I punch in three words, and search, we can see what it looks like. Well, 3 weeks after this gift was given, the king died. His son became Louis VII, King of the Franks, and Eleanor, Queen. And what was life like for the rich and famous of medieval France? Well, it was full of intrigue and power struggles. It was one such struggle between Pope Innocent II and Louis that caused a war in 1142. The net result was a storming of a town called Vitry and the burning of its church on Louis's orders. Sadly, over 1,000 of the town's villagers had taken refuge there, mostly women and children, and they all died. It was Eleanor who helped make amends with the Pope, and Louis, feeling guilt and remorse over the Vitry massacre, offered his services to head the Second Crusade. Eleanor's grandfather had gone on the First Crusade, and she was determined to go on this one. Louis had no choice. And so, two armies were raised. They left almost 500,000 strong in 1147. But by 1149, the few thousand left were in full retreat. It had been a disaster. And that wasn't the only disaster they brought back with them. Their relationship had been deteriorating for quite some time. And after 15 years of marriage, they were divorced. What else was going on in France? Well, an old abbey called St. Denis was being rebuilt, starting around 1140, and it ended up being the first building to have a true Gothic architectural style, a style that would soon sweep across Europe. Also, formerly lost books by Euclid and Ptolemy were first translated from Arabic to Latin, as well as the basics of algebra and the concept for the number zero. The Muslim world in general was much more advanced, and it wasn't uncommon for many a 12th century scholar to travel to Spain, half of which was still under Muslim control, to seek the new Arabic knowledge. There was also at this time a young man named Henry, who acquired Normandy and Anjou on the death of his father in 1151. He was also a thorn in King Louis's side, and was fast becoming his chief rival. He was 11 years younger than Eleanor, but they met and married. And within 2 years, through death and political intrigue, Henry was King of England, and Eleanor, once again, was a queen. They now ruled a country twice the size of what she had been queen of before, but that wasn't the most important thing she brought to England. This site certainly is hard to read, but it's worth the effort. It talks about the real passion in her life, a musical influence that she brought to the court first of France and then of England. An ideal that would spread through Europe throughout the next several hundred years, and is in some ways still with us today. It was the music of the troubadour. What was a troubadour? The troubadours were nobles who composed music and lyrics that were meant to be sung and played at court by their servants, called minstrels. And surprisingly, the first recorded troubadour was Eleanor's grandfather. Although his life was rather scandalous, it was from him that this cult of platonic love developed. Eleanor and her daughter set up the principles of courtly love. Eleanor introduced the ideas of chivalry and culture to her excessively masculine world, giving women of her court more of a say in their lives. They enjoyed cosmetics, fashion, and independent thinking. Green was the color of love. But it was a hard concept to fit into real life. And in the course of raising 5 sons and 3 daughters, whatever love Eleanor and Henry had for each other disappeared. Her oldest son, Henry, launched an unsuccessful revolt. She backed him, and for that, she was imprisoned in 1173. And she was to remain confined to various quarters for the next 15 years. It was during that confinement the construction began on the Cathedral of Notre Dame and London Bridge. The Holy Land fell once more under Muslim control, and Eleanor's son Henry died, leaving her son Richard as heir apparent. He wrested the throne from his father in 1189, freed his mother, and several days later, Henry II died, perhaps of a broken heart. King Richard I was soon off on the Third Crusade, leaving his 67-year-old mother in charge of the kingdom. With her other son, Prince Philip, it's said that she ruled justly, traveling across the countryside, reversing unjust laws, and freeing many from prisons. The characters of Richard the Lionhearted, off at the Crusades, and Prince Philip, ruling in his stead, are very familiar from one of the greatest legends of English history. But Eleanor's role as the writer of wrongs was assigned to a fictional character, Robin Hood. Eleanor's world was a violent one, punctuated by brief outbursts of peace. But instead of accepting it, she tried to change things by offering Europe an ideal to reach for.
In days gone by, there was a queen, a fool for love and all it means. Red ruby lips, don't touch me eyes, a fool for love and love is blind. A fool for love, a fool for love, a fool for love.
When Eleanor died at the age of 84, she left the world with chivalry and courtly love, ideals that remain to this day. Girls still grow up dreaming of finding that knight in shining armor, and songs of love still fill us with hope and longing. As always, the information's out there. You just have to find it. But in this case, the hardest information to find, then as now, is the truths behind the ideals.
In days gone by, there was a king, a fool for love and all it brings. So high and wide, could read your mind, a fool for love, and love is blind.